position and how this is not your boss's resource plan that we're going to be doing here. This is something very different. So we'll talk a bit about the rise of renewables and how to do planning with renewables, and that'll be about an hour and 15. And we'll finish up and talk about some new frontiers in resource planning with a focus on distributed energy resources and how to account for those, how to incorporate that. So why don't we just go around and just introduce ourselves. I know this is, you're all facing me, but let's all kind of look at each other and introduce ourselves and say our names, our titles slash role, and our organization, and what any questions you have or anything you'd like to get out of this session. So, want to start, Rex?
Sure. My name is Rex Jenkins. I'm from Ameren Utility in St. Louis, Missouri. I'm an analyst in the resource planning department. We're brand new with the Ascend Analytics. I mean, this is literally the first. We don't even have the floor. But I've been in resource planning for years. First in the conversation, not the specifics of the Ascend yet.
Great. All right. Thanks.
Brandon Colby with Cadmus Group. And I'm a principal there, responsible for our planning practice area. And I'm here because I want to hear what's going on with Ascend and everybody else in the resource planning area and see where Cadmus can help.
Just got the SIN, we're actually going through the implementation. So looking forward to learning a lot.
I'm Sumi Tan. Work with Pacific Gas and Electric. Our group does mostly price modeling and long-term contract valuation.
I'm Phil Rakowski with Fortilla, North America.
Okay, come in the right place.
Mike Romer, Kellogg Irrigation District. We're a small, relatively small, independent balancing authority in California, not part of the power. So we have a unique set of circumstances that causes us to have to balance our own portfolio and not have our bodies able to do it. So we have to acquire all of our resources, all of our reserves. In the market for our own generation, we have a lot of generation, which is maybe not the best thing with the distributed generation. And I do all the most of the forecasting and all of the purchases and sales of gas and depending on which is the most
important. Would it help to have passed the microphone around too? See, you might notice that everything is being videotaped as well, so I want to hear people.
Check, check.
All right, who gets it?
I'm Eric Stoutenberg at a company called NAPA, Vice President. We develop wind, solar, and energy storage projects. So I'm mostly here to understand how we can better site and plan our projects for our utility customers.
My name is Katie Hardman. I do energy resource planning at Colorado Springs Utilities, principal engineer. And so we do all the capacity expansion modeling. We do the production cost modeling and kind of investigation of the potential of future resources in our area.
Hi, I'm Allison Weiss, and I'm a senior energy analyst at Ascend Analytics. And I work on our capacity expansion modeling and also other optimization models for battery and renewable integration.
Hi, my name is Chad Raley. I also work at Ameren. I'm a project manager for our DER integration and renewables initiatives, and right now we're building a business case for an energy storage project in our service territory.
You're sitting next to the right person. She's working on your valuation.
Hello, Brent Selvage, IPL, or Indianapolis Power and Light Company. I work with Patrick and Will here on production cost modeling and resource planning.
I'm Stephen Handy with Reading Electric Utility, resource planner. We have just kicked off our IRP, so having Ascend Analytics for several years now, we hope that it's going to be really helpful and powerful for us to grind through that and get the IRP put together.
I'm Garrett LeBove from Puget Sound Energy. I'm a resource planning analyst, and I just started that job about 3 weeks ago from the trade floor, so I'm here to gain some perspective, still in the learning process of that.
I'm Jim Hennigan with Delta Montrose Electric Association. We're a rural electric cooperative in western Colorado. We've been working with David and Ascend for several months now. My responsibilities are developing renewable energy projects that are distributed energy resources within our service area. We're still under a wholesale power contract with our wholesale power supplier Tri-State, but we're in the process of attempting to negotiate an exit from that contract. So it turns out you have to plan for these power supplies if you do that. So that's what I'm here for today.
Gary, you want to introduce yourself? The man who needs no introduction.
I'm Gary Doris. I'm CEO of Ascend, and I'll be here, I think, augmenting Dave here and there in terms of presentation. And welcome, everybody, to eTown and the Ascend Summit.
All right. Thank you. All right, let's get started. So just basic ground rules. This is a pre-conference workshop, which means that we are all going to, it's not just me going to spout information at you. You're going to give information back. It's going to be a free exchange. So, you know, please participate. Please go ahead and raise your hand and ask questions. And we're going to do maybe a couple little exercises and get you know, some exchange going along. So, and let's get going. So, here we are, 2017, thinking about our resources plans for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. And, you know, we probably had more change in the past 5 or 10 years than the utility industry has had in the past 100. So this is what we call, what economists might call structural change. This is an economic condition. It occurs when an industry market changes how it functions or operates, but it basically means technology has made things, has changed the paradigm, and we need to change accordingly. So what are some examples? Well, the Industrial Revolution. This was obviously a fundamental change in human society, going from mostly agricultural living to one in which we're focused on manufacturing and people moving into cities. So this was obviously fundamental change, structural change. You know, one stat that's, I think is interesting is, you know, 1776, 99% of Americans were farmers. Today it's less than 1%. You know. Automobiles, the same sort of thing, the ability to use fossil fuel energy to fundamentally transform our transportation sector. And it allows us to do work much more efficiently. The computer chip, another fundamental transformation about information and information technology, and obviously is paved way for the internet and the revolution in communications. So we argue that we're in basically the same fundamental change right now in energy. And it's actually old technology, is fracking. Fracking is as old as drilling. But the combination of doing horizontal drilling and fracking has fundamentally changed the way we can capture natural gas very cheaply. And that's had fundamental effects on electricity, the electricity system. And also, of course, renewables. And we're going to spend a lot of time talking about renewables and about its effects on energy markets, on price formation, and what that means in terms of how do we do planning when we're looking at a future of variable energy resource instead of dispatchable. And so our first topic is very high level understanding energy transition. And so we'll talk about the structural change in the energy landscape, talk about the rise of renewable energy, what's driving it, and where are things going. The what's going on in wholesale energy markets? This is a sort of a hot topic. You know, we can have a good discussion about that. And what is the new planning paradigm with renewables? So the first thing we're going to look at is just EIA's most recent forecast. You know, it's just a forecast, and EIA is not known for being particularly good at predicting the future. But what we see here, and I don't think this has a laser pointer, but is that they're seeing natural gas here in blue and renewables in green, of course, is basically phasing in as coal and nuclear is phasing out. So why is that? Well, first let's talk about the demand side. On the demand side, what we see is basically flat and declining demand, and that's nationwide. We can see here on the lower left, we have 3%, this is, you know, U.S. annual residential electricity sales, 3% decline since 2010, and sales per capita is 7% decline. It's really dramatic. And this is, I mean, you can see, this is, when we're talking about structural change, this is a structural change. You have secularly increasing as we add more electronics and we have a lot of strong economic growth. We have the recession and something's changed, something's different. And so there's some of that is essentially structural economic change. The recession really accelerated a lot of trends that were already happening in terms of becoming more of a services-oriented economy. But also we have other things going on. We have policy that's driving things like energy efficiency and rooftop solar. This is particularly true in California, but it's growing elsewhere. We kind of get to the point where everybody has the number of TVs that they need and everyone has the appliances that they need. The only load that's actually growing is plug load, so you're just your devices. But you get to the point where every time you buy a new TV, it's more efficient. And everything is not only getting from energy efficiency programs, but just, you know, the natural trend of things getting more efficient as technology improves. So we have this situation where demand is flat. And this utility model is basically built on the concept of load is always growing. And so we're always building these plants to supply that. And that's different. So that's the demand side. On the supply side, as we alluded to before, shale gas has also just changed everything. If you asked, you know, 20 years ago if we'd be powering all of the power plants with natural gas, they probably would have laughed at you. Right? It was way too expensive. And so now you have a situation where, you know, starting really in 2009, you get on this trend, and it's sort of gone unabated in terms of shale gas production here in the top. The bottom, you can see how it's affected prices. And you have, you know, you can see the economic cycles very clearly, 2001, 2006, 2008. And then it's just been popping around basically below $5, you know, $2-3 minimum BTU, and it's never recovered. They only had a little bit of a spike here in 2014. That was a polar vortex, and You got it. Oh, thanks. I can put this on my phone, too. Perfect. Boom. Now I have Gary's phone. All right. Let's talk about renewables. Obviously, renewable portfolio standards have had a big effect. And this is just showing the map of the U.S. This is of February 2017. California was 50%, Oregon now 50%, Hawaii 100% by 2045. And we helped Hawaii come up with their power supply improvement plan to get figure out how they're going to get there. And we'll talk about that. I think Gary's going to talk about that later, what that means. And it's very interesting. And so, you know, this is also, you know, we're probably going to be seeing 100% RPS in California. Not this year. It didn't happen. But if I was going to make a forecast and put money on it, I would put that. Next year, it will pass in some form. May not be 100% renewables, it may be 100% clean energy, but that's what I would expect. We also have tax credits that support renewables. We have the solar investment tax credit, 30% federal tax credit against the liability of residential, commercial, or utility investors in solar energy. Of course, this is going to be being phased out. It's going from 26, it goes to 26% in 2020, 22% in 21. After that, it's a permanent 10. Sorry about the typo. So if you're going to put solar panels on your roof, do it before 2020. just get the maximum benefit, if it makes sense for you. So SEPA, it's now Smart Energy Power Association, they changed the name, expects 27 gigawatts of solar energy installed in the U.S. by the end of 2015 and to get to 100 by 2020. Wind also enjoys a production tax credit, 2.3 cents per kilowatt hour, also getting phased out. Also, interestingly enough, is the drive from the customer perspective in order to get more green energy onto their for their load. This is really being pushed by the technology sector. Here in 2012, Google started procuring renewables just to cover their data center load. We now see Facebook, Microsoft getting in the mix, Walmart, IKEA, Procter & Gamble, Owens Corning, Amazon, more Google, more Amazon, and this continues. This trend is growing. I mean, there was definitely a spike in 2015, but it continues to grow. Sometimes these are basically enabled by tariffs that the utilities are devising for these customers who are really demanding this green energy. For example, PSE has a green direct tariff, and it's allowed. It's allowed large commercial customers in order to get green energy. So, to quote American Advanced Energy Economies says, why do we need to know this? Well, planners need to assume a market-based green tariff will attract a certain portion of the utility's existing load and then factor that into an integrated resources plan. So this is what the customers are, some customers are demanding, and utilities are working with them to be able to enable that while also trying to not strand any assets. Too many things in my hand. So we've seen dramatic declines in PV costs. Maybe this is the policy that has helped kickstart the industry, and the industry has really pushed the envelope on the manufacturing and really driven down costs. This is a very fresh report from Lawrence Berkeley National Lab, and we can just see the trend very clearly from. These are PPA prices, and we start with California. This was probably, I'm sure this was PG&E having to take $200 PPA prices for renewables. This is stuff that is really driving down to where it's sub 50 now. I think It was Tucson Electric Power that got solar at 35. I think that was also firmed with storage. So this is, you know, clearly this is something that has been helped by subsidies, but it's getting to the point at which subsidies is really no longer needed to maintain the momentum. Wind as well. Wind is really driven down by, we've had a 61% decrease in the price of wind from 2009 to 2015. This is, you know, a few years old, but it's gone down even more. Why? Really sort of advanced manufacturing techniques, much larger turbines, and so you're getting bigger economies of scale. Some advances in the turbine technology and just its efficiency to be able to capture wind, even in slow wind days, it's able to keep spinning. And so that means, you know, higher capacity factors. So now it's 41% in 2014, 31% in 2004. It's the same picture just for wind. And you can see, again, we're getting down here, sub 20. I think you can get $15 wind in Iowa. So So what does this mean? Well, it means that we're adding a lot of new generation, renewable generation, onto the grid. And what that does is that this is a supply stack. It just pushes the supply stack to the right. And what you're doing is you're adding it here in this part of the supply stack. So the wind is zero, you know, zero variable cost. And you're pushing out all these to the right. So what does that do? Well, it basically means the market has got more energy than it really needs. And some of these guys are going to have to exit, right? I'm going to see if I can exit out of here. So this is CAISO data, and this is looking at the relationship between renewables. This is renewable generation. These are hours, hourly dots, and the colors are the year. So red is 2017, black is 2016, and green is 2015. And what you see is renewables output and then the heat rate. Heat rate's just energy price divided by the natural gas price, just controls for the price of natural gas. And what you see is, you know, a clearly declining trend showing that basically as more renewables are generating, the heat rate and the prices decline. It's pretty straightforward. But here you see it visually very clearly. So talk a little bit about markets. This shows the U.S. and the various markets that we have. These colors are the organized electricity markets, ISOs, RTOs. Obviously, CAISO, MISO, PJM, NYISO, ISO New England, SPP. They're also looks like they're gonna be expanding SPP here in Colorado. And these are various pricing nodes. You can see, you know, even though you still have these pricing nodes here, even if you're not in an organized market, you just don't have the same computer markets. But you can still buy and sell. So this is, you know, the Western Electric Coordinating Council. We basically have three grids in the U.S., Eastern Interconnect, and of course Texas. Got ERCOT, and you know, everything. Texas has to do everything its own way, so it's down here, not regulated by FERC. So we're looking at various pricing nodes. This is Blue's Palo Verde, which is, you can go rest, but back here, right there. It's a big nuclear plant, also very close to CAISO and all the renewables down here. Indiana. This is for you guys. Got Mid-C is up here, the northwest. NP15 and SP15, this is CAISO, and ERCOT. And you can see here, this is, taking the long view. It almost looks the same, very similar to the demand side, which makes sense. But you had growth in energy prices, average, these are sort of average wholesale prices. You have the rate recession, demand goes down, prices go down. And then also concurrently, we saw earlier that the natural gas price was basically crashing as well and staying extremely low. So you have lower and lower prices, and then more and more renewables are coming on at this point, and the market prices are dropping even more. So what does that mean? It means it's been very hard for folks who need prices up here, 40, to be economically viable. And that means nuclear and coal are going to struggle, especially merchant and especially in these organized markets. And we see that here. This is actually an example of a coal plant that's in WEC. And this is the number of profitable days at the Palo Verde node. So this is looking from 2014, in which you had plenty of days in which the plant is in the money. And then basically by 2015, the plant is only in the money in the summer. And that seems to be the pattern, that it's basically unprofitable most of the year. So you get down, so 228 days, down to 29 days, 26, and 21. You cannot run a coal power plant on that kind of money. And so as we see, basically, this is the retirements. As you might expect, coal is a big loser. And it's rapidly losing coal fleets. And you also see some natural gas. This is 2015, so I would expect that this is even more now. But that you have natural gas, steam turbines, so some of the less not as efficient natural gas units are going out too. Petroleum liquids. So it says 80% of retirements were conventional steam coal in 2015. And this trend is supposed to continue. Natural gas increases from 19% in 2005 to 26% in 2015. And this continues. Same sort of story for nuclear. This is just some recent news on nuclear. Diablo Canyon, sort of near and dear to me and SUNY. I used to work at PG&E with SUNY. Before coming to Ascend, and we worked on the Diablo Canyon analysis to figure out should we relicense this plant. And Diablo Canyon is really the jewel of PG&E's generation fleet, and one of the best run, most efficient nuclear power plants in the country. Provides 25% of California's clean energy, and yet we couldn't find a way that it would be economically viable. In 2024, 2025, because we're adding so many renewables to the system during the middle of the day when during the solar peak, you basically have prices approaching zero. So energy during the middle of the day is basically worth almost nothing. And you can't run a nuclear power plant like that. We're also losing all of our load to community choice aggregation, but that's another story. We can talk about that at happy hour. But you can see this is sort of constant stream of news about nuclear in trouble. Um, So that brings us to where we are today in the past couple weeks. So we have a FERC notice of proposed rulemaking on fuel resiliency. So this is it's not unprecedented, but it happens very rarely that DOE will actually go to FERC and say, we want a rulemaking here. It's only happened two other times. And so it's the performance baseload study, right? And the baseload study, it's interesting, you know, they had a leak study before it actually came out officially. And the leak study said that, you know, renewables aren't actually a threat to grid reliability. And that, you know, the main reason for the exit of a lot of these or coal and nuclear plants is cheap gas. And nationwide, that's true. But in the end, you know, they finally say, well, you know, this is a threat to the resiliency of the grid. And this is sort of a value that is unpriced. What is the value of resiliency? What does that even mean, resiliency? And what they're saying is like, well, you know, in extreme weather, you might have constrained gas supplies, and therefore plants with 90 days of fuel on site are critical to the grid. We got to have them around. We got to make sure they don't exit. So that means coal piles or nuclear power plants. Although in very cold weather, coal piles actually freeze and you can't use them. So, you know, be that as it may. So they've asked the FERC to have a fast track process on doing a sort of a cost of service regulation mechanism. So basically means that you know, these power plants and organized electricity markets, and you know, that have this 90-day fuel supply, can actually just go ahead and recover all their costs plus a reasonable rate of return. So guaranteed profit just for having this capability. So it's primarily just for merchant coal and nuclear plants. There's not a ton of merchant coal out there. Maybe less than a dozen plants. A lot of merchant nuclear, mostly out east. So, anyways, according to a Rhodium Group study, they did a study of the last 5 years of all the major power disruptions nationwide over the past 5 years. Only 0.0007% were due to fuel supply problems. The vast majority were the result of just severe weather knocking down power lines. So, what is this about? Well, We have lots of opinions. This is John Wellinghoff, former FERC chairman, and who says, you know, this could blow up wholesale electricity markets. And, you know, because you're basically putting your thumb on the scale and picking these plants as the winners. And it's, you know, the whole concept of markets, where you have efficient entry and exit based on pricing, it's, you know, basically just forget about it. You know, what, you know, the markets, there's no, you know, the market is no longer there if you're going to do that. But then, you know, Rick Perry's Secretary of Energy, also former Dancing of the Stars star, said, it's really important to understand in general terms, there is no free market in the energy industry. And anybody who stands up and says, you're affecting the free market, well, there is no free market. So that's interesting, pretty amazing to hear. What he's saying is, like, look, we're already supporting renewables, right? And we have ITC, and we've already, you know, basically, you know, there we don't really have a true free market where everything's competing on its own without subsidies. So let's hear what you guys think. Anybody want to offer an opinion on the matter?
I have a question.
Yeah.
What's motivating the DOE to want to have this regulation?
Let me put it out to the audience. Let's see any thoughts. It's a good question. Why would the DOE want to do this? What's in it? Why do they think that this is? And yeah, we have a mic. Someone wants to take it.
They were told to do it.
They were told to do it. Told by whom?
My opinion is that this is a political motivation to try and fulfill something of a campaign promise to keep coal functioning economically, because I don't think it can do so on its own. And having read the Federal Register notice of the proposed rulemaking, how they try to substantiate the need to create a more resilient fuel supply seems pretty easy to shoot holes in. So I don't think it's related to true resiliency in the electric power market.
Mm-hmm. Do people think it's worth having mechanisms that do support the concept of resiliency? And what does that, you know, what does that really mean?
So we've looked at this a lot. I think when I think of reliability, that's keeping the lights on. Right? So that's making sure that it's there. Resiliency is how quickly you come back from an outage. Those are the basic definitions. So thinking about MISO, 90% of MISO are vertically integrated utilities. We first and foremost have an obligation to serve. Our number one concern is typically reliability. So whatever decisions we make, we will be thinking about that. We also want to provide affordable, you know, low cost, reliable, safe energy, all that stuff. So I mean, I think it is important. And when you think about MISO's different than say PJM, and that 90% of it is vertically integrated utilities who have an obligation to serve. Those utilities and states are going to dictate their resource decisions. So I do think it's important. Whether or not this is the right way to do it, I have no comment.
This is a politically safe space, by the way. Yeah. All right, anybody else want to weigh in on this? Gary?
Yeah, I think Jim's probably right. I mean, this is a political sphere, and this is a political answer to address a campaign promise, is my intuition as well. And the reason for that is it doesn't make sense. Fundamentally, you're inducing a highly inflexible resource to be there for resiliency when you need resources that are highly flexible and adaptable, the nimble, not the lethargic coal. Unfortunately, falls into the lethargic category in terms of resource responsiveness. So it's the wrong answer to this issue of renewable integration and the inexorable rise of renewables is to keep more baseload, to squeeze what resources out? Oh, the renewables. And actually exacerbates the problem and doesn't do anything, in my opinion, really to address the issue of resiliency. It's kind of enshrouding the dimension of resiliency to motivate a scare towards we have to keep coal.
Yeah.
That's how I see it, plain and simple. Coal has a short life, and this is maybe just a last little help, but the days are numbered probably, just because, as you said, the costs are coming down, and their inflexibility is a detriment to their long-term value.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk a little bit about integrated resources planning. We've got a few new planners, so this is good. This is a good background. Just a little bit of history. So, you know, the heyday of the integrated resources plan. Well, first of all, what is an integrated resources plan? Let's start with that. Actually, I'm going to ask the audience. Somebody, tell me what is an integrated resources plan, and why do you do this thing? Okay, so a regulator tells you to do it, but then what do you use the output to do? Like, what is the functional purpose of it?
The functional purpose is to provide the regulators what is our plan for meeting our
what is our plan for adding capacity, retiring capacity? What's the mix of resources, and what's the financial implications associated with that for our customers?
Right. Great. Yeah, that's a really good definition. So it is a plan, and it's a long-term plan, so obviously things change. But it is a trajectory. It is a strategy for how the utility is going to evolve in the future to be able to provide supply to meet customer demand. And so this is, it's we look at it as decision analysis. So this is, how do we make the most prudent decision you can based on the fact that you have an enormous amount of uncertainty about the future? And so we want to capture that. And so, but this is, going back in history, the traditional model was that the utility was vertically integrated, meaning it provided generation, transmission, and distribution to customers. It was a one-way flow, and the utility basically owned the whole process. This was sort of the Edison model through, the 90s. The 70s started the concept of wholesale markets and merchant generation. So that was a change. So we'll say, Edison to 1978 when PURPA was passed. So, you had your generation resources, you had a mix of fuels, and that was good because it managed, fuel price risk. You have your transmission, then you distribute it to customers, and basically the regulatory commission will, approve the plan or not. And this will help you basically as you're asking for, capital projects, is it in the plan, is it not in the plan? Helps make those decisions. And so what we're trying to do is basically expand capacity at least cost given a load growth projection, right? And load was growing, and so we were doing capacity expansion. Today, load is not growing, so I think that term is actually out of date, because we're really not expanding capacity, we're just managing it. But this was, good, easy days, building lots of plants, making money. Then in the 1990s, in the 70s, you had PURPA, which allowed merchant generators to get in and have a market for electricity. In the 90s, we started to look at things like, maybe we should split up generation, transmission, distribution, because the only true natural monopoly is the distribution side. And you can have independent system operator and nonprofit basically run the market and have optimize the resources, dispatch them according to least cost, and manage the traffic there. And then you can have generators be merchant plants. They're bidding into the market and they bid their resources when the price of the market bears their marginal cost. And if demand is high and some really high-cost generator is on the margin, is the marginal unit providing electricity, they set the market price. And all those guys in the previous stack, they just get to rake in the money, bringing it in. So that worked great when prices were nice and high. And then some states even have retail competition, which I can't imagine, because I've never lived in one of those states where someone might actually be trying to market you to go switch your electricity provider. but that does happen. And so IRPs kind of slipped away at the wayside. They weren't as popular. It was kind of like, we're just going to let the market decide. The market's going to, we don't need to plan because the market is just going to fix everything. Well, we had some problems in the early 2000s, California energy crisis, obviously being the biggest, and we had a lot of number of re-regulation. But we still maintain the independent system operator, what we saw before, all those guys on the map. Now, here we are, and it's 2017, and we're concerned about environmental values, and we're concerned about climate change, irregardless of what's, in Washington temporarily for now. Overall, over the country and the states where where energy policy is really made. We're very concerned about reducing greenhouse gas emissions. And so we have, you know, environmental, not just greenhouse gas, but air quality. And, you know, with water as well, once through cooling regulations, for example. So we have all these environmental policy objectives. And we also have, on top of that, new technology. So on the, we now have a situation where the customer is also generating energy and using energy in very different ways. So we have bidirectional flow, we have electric vehicles, behind-the-meter batteries, and we need to understand and take that into account. What is the customer doing? How is the customer's actions affecting the grid? And how's the downstream affecting up here? We used to only worry about this way, now we have to worry about both ways. And then add on to that, we need to optimize to be able to meet RPS standards. We need to actually be able to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. In California, SB 350 is a law that's basically mandating that the utilities get to 50% RPS by 2030, and they meet greenhouse gas emissions targets. And they actually have to have measurable progress meeting those targets. And so now we have to say, we need to actually retire emissions emitting resources before their economic life, because we need to meet these greenhouse gas standards. So that's now become the optimization problem. Not how to meet load, because we've got that covered. It's how to meet these objectives. And this is the first use of an emoji in a presentation, by the way. Ever. So here's the changing power planning paradigm. This is just a standard from the book flow model of how to do an integrated resources plan. You start with load forecasts, you identify your goals, you look at your existing resources, you try and assess your need for new resources, whether that's supply, demand side, T&D, look at the rates, how the rate structures work. Then we look at what's the optimal resource mix. Looking at social and environmental factors, we think about uncertainty, and then we send it to the PUC and say, this is it, have at it. It's a cycle. But now, the new planning paradigm is we need to think about economic retirements and uneconomic retirements, actually. I guess maybe that's the same thing, but. Stranded assets. So we've invested all this money in this, this power plant, and we just have to retire because it's not clean enough or it's not economic anymore. Well, that's a stranded asset. How do you deal with that? Who's on the hook for that? Environmental goals and mandates, but also policy uncertainty. We saw with this NOPA rule and other sort of policy gyrations that we have policy uncertainty. How do we deal with that? Okay, any questions on this first part? 9:30. All right, how are people feeling? Do they want a quick break or do you want to keep powering on? Keep powering? Okay, sounds good. All right, planning with renewables. So we'll talk a bit about net load and price formation. And we'll talk about renewable energy's effects on volatility, heat rates, and prices. We'll be talking about price spikes, why they happen, are they increasing, and, well, is that a bad thing? We'll talk about the sort of physical characteristics of renewable generation and why it's important that we understand weather's effect on renewables. Weather is basically the new fuel. You have renewables, right? And so how do we deal with that? How do we deal with that in our modeling? How do we do that from an operational perspective? So this is why simulations matter more than ever. And this is, basically, cut to the bottom line is that this is why with PowerSim, this is why we do simulations, because we have to capture these new dynamics. We have to be able to capture the effect of weather on renewables and the effect of renewables on supply, the supply mix, and then how that affects prices. And also, how does weather affect load? And how do those interactions work? Well, to do that, we have to have realistic weather, and we have to capture a full range of weather uncertainty. And that's what, you know, we're doing with PowerSim, is trying to capture these new market dynamics. So this is California. Let's go to California. And so we have a lot of solar in California. And so it's what we're seeing here is in 2014 is this dark red. I'm not sure, is this thing actually working? Okay, I think this thing's not, it's like dying. Whatever. So you have the situation. This is 2014. This is the solar output. This is just average for the year. And then this is 2015 and 2016. So obviously we're adding more and more solar to the system. What you see here, this is the heat rates. Again, it's electricity price divided by natural gas. So what you're seeing here is an interesting pattern that's changing. First thing to notice is that power prices are declining on average, so we talked about that earlier. And so we've gone from $47 per megawatt hour down to 36. So you need to notice today, it must be getting lower than that. Probably like 30. Yeah. So, and then you have also, but things are increasing here in the morning ramp. So this was, you know, this was 2014, and this is 2016. So what you have is you have this increasing pattern, and then the prices crash in the middle of the day. And then you have a big increasing heat rates during the evening ramp. So why is that? Anybody want to make a guess? Who hasn't seen this slide before? So why would prices be increasing in the shoulders during the ramps like this? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, right. So the solar's going away, or it's coming on, and you have this ramp. This quick, you know, this ramp down, and you have this ramp up, and then you have what the economists call scarcity rents or scarcity pricing, which means there's just fewer units available, and they're, you know, less efficient to be able to pick up that ramp. So it's just like you know, a hotel or Uber. It's basically Uber, right? It's just a surge price, and also you have a lot of plants now that basically are completely unprofitable here, but they want to be available for here and here, and they have, you know, long startup times and startup costs, and they got to collect those startup costs in a shorter amount of time, so their bids are higher. So okay, you know, that's interesting enough. What about volatility? So that was just looking at average prices. This is looking at volatility. So this is California, and you have this is renewables on the top from 2014 to 2016. You have renewables going from 7% to 22% of load, and you have the volatility of the day ahead price. So this is volatility is just standard deviation of prices, basically. Going from 40% to 60%. And also at the same time, when you're looking at real time, volatility is going from 50% to doubles to 100%. So prices are going much more volatile. Any thoughts why? What about solar generation?
That graph you showed earlier, right? So
mm-hmm.
you've got lower belly hours and higher
mm-hmm. hours. So. Mm-hmm. It's part of it, yep.
It's also it's variable, right? There's cloud cover, there's storms.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep, that's right. That's exactly right. We're talking about variable generation. And I'm going to exit here and go to something on my desktop. So let's look at some prices. And so this is 2016 CAISO. And you can what you can see is, well, it's spiky. So we'll zoom in a little bit. And you can see, zoom in, let's keep going. Actually, let's look at spring. Zoom in a little bit more. Okay, now you're starting to see a green line. So the green line is day ahead price. And the orange line is real time. I think I should do this. So what we're doing is we're seeing this the spiky patterns to, you know, 1,000. So there's a price cap in CAISO of 1,000. And so you're getting these price spikes. Most price spikes are, you know, over 100, but you can kind of see that the day-ahead price, very quiescent. Doesn't really go up and down that much. Not super volatile, but you do see this increasing and really, you know, this increasing volatility in the real-time markets. And it's because a lot of the renewables are basically bidding in the real-time market, getting that price, and they're going up and down. And so variability in weather and your meteorological conditions is forces variability in the output, and that you see that in the prices. You say, and the markets say, well, oh crap, we need like more energy now, and so they're going to spike up the prices to get that. So then we notice some interesting patterns when it comes to these price spikes. So this is basically a price spike is over $100, and this is each month. And what we're seeing is that there is a definite pattern mostly in the May, June, July, August, September, October, in which you can basically see that towards 6 o'clock in the evening, you start to get more of these price spikes. The reason is because there's more load in those hours, and so the system is basically stretched more. The variability is much more important to price spikes because there's just fewer things to absorb it. Weather forecasting tends to be a little more difficult in the spring. So, you know, what if I was a very flexible unit and I wanted to try and take advantage of this? When would I decide? Let's just say, okay, say I'm a battery. I'm just thinking about a merchant battery project, and I want to play regulation, you know, ancillary services, or I want to play energy. How do I decide when I should be in which market? Can't be in both. Well, you can do some fancy forecasting analytics, which Ascend can help you with. Just talk to me later. Or you can just look at this chart and say, oh, obviously I should be in real-time energy. It's May. It's 6 o'clock. I should be in real-time energy and playing that. And you know, also what we observe is that there's increasing probability of price spikes as renewables, as there's more renewables. Looks fairly linear, although we've seen in Texas it starts to really curve up like an almost exponential function as you add more. So what's the take home? Well, renewables are the new base source of energy, and it's lowering power costs. So what we see is that renewables are increasing the market price volatility. So what does it mean? Well, it means flexibility is the new source of value. And conversely, inflexibility is a source of cost. And again, that's why coal, nuclear, inflexible baseload is going to have more and more of a problem living peacefully with the future driven by renewables. So the game is really, the concept of baseload is sort of going away. It's about renewable integration. What do we do to keep the system in balance? How do we integrate renewables? It's a good spot to take actually a 10-minute break. Does that sound good to you?
That we can count on energy from those for those first, you know, hundreds of thousands of megawatt hours. And
right.
If they weren't so prolific, they wouldn't be the new baseload energy?
Right. I mean, they're baseload because they are coming in at the, you know, at the bottom of the stack.
By price.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, and then, you know, you can look at CAISO, let's look at. And I know I always go back to CAISO, but this is sort of the leading edge. Let's look at today's demand. So you know, this is your normal load shape for this time of year. Yesterday looked kind of the same. And you have this, you know, this is the solar coming on. And so this, you know, from seven, you know, let's look at, you know, from seven through seven. This is the base load during these hours, and it's basically zero cost. It can even be bid negative because it's got tax credits and renewable energy attributes associated with it. That's why you see, you know, negative pricing in CAISO. So that's the reason why it's and as we add more renewables, especially wind. Wind tends to have a less of a shape, obviously. Wind will, you know, this is, if you're looking at Texas, it might be coming in down. You know, wind dies down a little bit in the day, but it comes back up a little more of a U shape. So that's being a certain amount of that is pretty much you can count on it. The variability does come in here. You can see, you know, on a minutely, sub-hourly time scale, it's variable. Yeah. Net demand, it's off the chart. So when in this time of year, California is like pretty hot right now, actually, because of the fires. It's sort of unusual. But in the spring, load is low because it's not that cold, not that hot. And there's abundant sunshine, so you get these, that's where you get the overgeneration issues, where you get the net load. So this net load is just load minus renewables. That's where you get the problems with overgen, negative pricing. This seems to be off the chart a little bit, but this is yesterday's net load. You can see the duck. And then Let's see if we can look and see it. I just wanted to bring this up. This is, so Ascend is moving a lot of our visualizations to Microsoft BI, Power BI. So this is just looking at, this is CAISO again, and this is dark load is net load, and the light one is regular load, and this is heat rate. And you know, obviously, they're pretty close together here in the winter when there's not a lot of sun, and then you start to get quite a bit of divergence in the spring, and here in the summer. And then we can zoom in. This is the fun part. So let's look at May. Or actually, let's look at, yeah. And now you get to see all the ducks in a row. Duck, quack, 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 quack. But again, here, you know, here's again what the thermal fleet is having to deal with. It's going up and down, up and down, up and down. And then you can see the effect on heat rate. So, you know, these are ostensibly price formation is now a function of net load, not load. It's not your necessarily just, you know, where your load and supply curves meet and what the marginal generator is anymore. It's about where you are in the net load curve. You can see, look at this. I think this corresponds huge. Look at this huge day of renewables with this plummet. Look, the heat rate's zero. So basically, energy, any additional energy is worth nothing, right? And then. Yeah, that's right.
And
yeah, up here. Right. Yeah, California is about 3 years ahead of schedule on the duck curve. And then you can drill down, just see individual days. So we're, you know, for our clients, we're looking to add a lot more of these sort of dynamic visualizations to our outputs. And so you can bring this to your boss, your management, be able to do let them click around. It's really powerful. So, all right. So let's talk a bit about, any other questions? Thank you. Any questions, comments, concerns? Write your congressman. All right. All right, so let's talk a little bit about flexibility. What does that mean? It's not just doing yoga. You have, so I think everybody knows this, but you know, we'll just state it again here, is that balancing authorities, so that's either the ISO itself or if you're just an integrated utility and not in an organized market. I was recently told you're not supposed to say unorganized market. That's a no-no. It's just vertically integrated. So a lawyer told me that, by the way. So the you know, customers, you know, obviously they demand energy, and that the variability in that demand is primarily driven by weather and, you know, time of day. And people get up and turn on the coffee makers, and then it gets hot and they turn on their ACs, or it gets cold and they turn on their heaters. And then on the supply side, you have, we have to have our generators provide the electricity in real time. And we have to keep supply and demand balanced, you know, at all times instantaneously. And keeping it balanced keeps the frequency of electricity at 60 hertz. And if you get just a little bit low, 59.9, you know, 59.91, you start to get into real trouble, and you can have, you know, catastrophic grid failures. So you know, that is the fundamental job one of reliability, is keeping this system balanced. And so that was not, you know, if the variability is only demand, can deal with that. It's not that variable. But now we're adding the fact that supply is variable. So, you know, the renewable supply is driven by weather. It's driven by how much sun, the amount of clouds, whether the wind's blowing. Sometimes you have long droughts of wind. And so, you know, you need the rest of the fleet to be able to be there in order to integrate the renewables. So when we think about flexible capacity, we need to think in terms of time scales. So we need to think about how to manage variations between generation and load in a very short, like sub 5 minutes time scale, minutely. And then we think of that in terms of the ancillary service called regulation. So this is just power plants or batteries moving up and down just very quickly in order to manage those little short-term fluctuations. And you know, renewables are going to drive more need for more regulation. We need more resources to do this. And that can be, you know, either adding, you know, thermal units can do it, hydro is really good at it. The batteries are also really good at it. Intra-hour, so when we're looking at, you know, how to manage short ramps that are between the start and the end of the hour, we call that INC or DEC. So that's basically in the 15-minute time scale. So that is, can you ramp up 10 megawatts in less than 15 minutes? And you need to do that in order to keep your system frequency basically within the acceptable bounds according to the NERC standards. And so fast ramping resources are the ones that are going to be able to do this. That can be batteries again. It can be a Wärtsilä engine. Wärtsilä engines have basically the ability to ramp up extremely quickly and basically zero or very low startup costs. So they can start and stop. We find that INC is typically more valuable than DEC. It's easier to turn down than it is to ramp up. So, and then multi-hour, so this is thinking about how do we deal with the duck curve issue. And so this is thinking of a couple, you know, 1 hour to 3-4 hours. This is what we basically just call load following. This is just the ability to have enough resources to be able to meet the increasing load. And you know, we can add, you know, have bigger markets to be able to get more resources, more resource diversity. We can retire inflexible baseload, have better renewable forecasting, can curtail. It's a lot of options to deal with that. We find that the most pressing, the most binding constraint in terms of flexibility is the intra-hour, is the ability for your units to ramp up very quickly in that 15-minute time scale to get your system back into frequency, the right frequency. This is just a visual, this is Hawaii. We'll come back to this. Gary will go into a lot of depth about Hawaii. But this is just a visual showing, again, how thermal is going to work with renewables. And this is, you know, this is looking at 2025. Customer load is the dotted red line, and you have the renewable generation is in the yellow. That's both solar and wind. So you see again, ramp up, down, up, down, up, down. But you can see that, you know, it's changeable. It's pretty high these days, not so much these days, you know, high again, low again, and the thermal is compensating. And at some point, and I'm not sure if this shows it, but you have situations in which, you know, you even though you have batteries, you have situations in which the resource, the renewable resources are not sufficient to recharge your batteries overnight, and you still need thermal in order to pick up the slack, even in a very high renewable system. So getting rid of the thermal just to be able to make to cover your position is very difficult. Very difficult. With Hawaii, we were only able to do it in a 100% renewable way because you start to convert some of these units to biodiesel. And biodiesel is very expensive, but you can do it. So why do we care? What's the big point? So the big point is that we need to capture these new dynamics in our modeling and our planning. So weather, weather is the new fuel and weather is always changing. So that means we need to simulate realistic weather, and we need to understand what that does to generation performance and what that does to price formation. So with PowerSim, we're looking at 20, 30 years of weather data, and we're linking renewable assets to specific weather stations, and we're simulating realistic weather pathways. And so we can actually capture these dynamics. Second point is reliance on renewables means we need to manage this volumetric uncertainty of supply. So again, we need to, like we saw before, we need to understand what the uncertainty of the supply is, and how does the thermal fleet deal with that? Do we have the resources, fast start, low startup costs, flexible resources to be able to integrate those renewables? The third point is that your model should match these emerging market conditions. So if you're running your model and you can't actually even meet today's conditions, you can't actually match it, then your model is not performing. That's why we do extensive validations with PowerSim. We'll show some of the slides to show that we're actually matching these changing market dynamics. And then also our price expectations. So we need to capture the fact that average prices are declining. We need to capture the fact that volatility is increasing. And then finally, we just need to make sure that we're aligning renewable supply with market prices. And sometimes that means we need to even be drilling down into the sub-hourly dynamics in order to capture the volatility of those price spikes, right? So this is a very simplified description of what PowerSim is trying to do. But again, it's weather is the fundamental driver. And we're looking at what it does to renewables, what that does to your load, and how does your thermal fleet operate in reaction? And then what is the effect on prices? So we do stochastic simulations. So I think most people are familiar, but basically we're looking at a fold distribution of possible outcomes. Instead of a single deterministic result, would just be the orange line. And you say, oh, great, we planned for this orange line. We're all set. Well, reality is a lot different than your base case assumption. It can be really this huge range. So we want to plan for, the mean, but you also want to plan and be able to make sure that you're going to be okay. You're covered in the extremes, at the tails. So, deterministic modeling, we're really missing the critical scenarios. And then when we're not simulating weather, we're basically fundamentally undervaluing the value of flexibility. And that's key. We got to capture the value of flexibility in order to manage the weather uncertainty from weather and renewables. Okay. So this is the PowerSim diagram. I don't know, Gary, did you want to do this, or do you want me? Okay. Mammy, I can do it.
Give you a break. All right. This is a long time. So there are a few dynamics here that David's touched upon. One is weather is the key driver to the new market, and how weather is becoming the new fundamental variable we really need to keep our eyes on. So we're going to look at weather for your load, your renewables, and also the system conditions. Because, as David said, it's the new fuel driving prices. So we always thought of gas, a fair bit of folks actually downstairs from those regions, hydro. And you can't overlook the impact of weather
on renewables, and we include hydro as renewables, as unpolitic as it may be. Supply fundamentals, supply and transmission, this is also a physical component of the system. And what we want to do is capture the dimensions of new additions to the supply stack and transmission and how this too impacts market prices. So we have a hybrid approach of structural components, standard supply and demand, as well as some of the newer drivers that are trying to maintain consistency with market dynamics. And this is critical. We can always pretend that the markets worked where we had the units on a fundamental basis being ramped at least costs to serve load and try to rig the model to be consistent with the market dynamics. That's proving to be a trying task as weather becomes the key driver, the new fuel. When you're dispatching everything based on marginal cost of production, you're going to fall short inevitably because you're not simulating weather and you're using normalized load profiles, using normalized production for wind and solar. And that has, a dimension of failing to recognize the market prices. So we have to benchmark to observed prices and calibrate. And that calibrates both to historic, what we've observed, and what's going forward based on new fundamentals. One of the key components is the monthly time blocks. So we look at forward prices in the near term, balance a month the next 5 years. We have a relatively liquid market. Beyond that, it's a forecast, but it's the same monthly blocks, on-peak, off-peak, and natural gas. We want to take those blocks of energy as we have them and have observed them historically and say, okay, how do they relate to each other? Let's evolve them forward so we have some dimensions of uncertainty. We have to make certain, though, that the average of all these prices equals the forecast or the market forward curve. So we're going to be consistent with market expectations or forecasts, and that's our monthly block. We're going to do 100 sim reps into the future of these, let's say, day by day, month by month. And so if you're at 50, you might have a range of power going from 35 to 75, and that's a spread. We have a whole bunch in between. That's okay. And obviously that price of power at 35 is going to relate probably to a little lower gas price, and at 75, quite a bit higher gas price. That's the commodity relationship. So we want to maintain those. And then we get into the during delivery spot conditions once this walk, as we call it, it's called a random walk, right? Using stochastic process, you have to use geometric Brownian motion with mean inversion to be specific. But for most humans, it's just, hey, these guys adding some uncertainty to the forward prices. And does it look reasonable? Do we add, quote unquote, meaningful uncertainty? Anybody can add noise. The question is the noise consistent with the new fundamentals of today's market and market expectations? And that's what we have to realize. We have to achieve a kind of a higher standard of uncertainty so that we're making our decisions based on the key drivers of today, and we can validate and substantiate all these drivers. There's a lot of validation tests in order to say we've realized meaningful uncertainty. One of the key ones is you mean of your simulations equals your forwards on a monthly level or forecasts. That's one. Do you benchmark to the weather? Have you probabilistically enveloped that well? Do you have all the weather stations correlated with each other? Do you have solar radiance and temperature lined up with each other and wind? Simple physical dimensions, but has to be done. Those in turn drive renewables. That's just a straight function, frankly. But you capture a lot of variability. Then we're going to go into dispatch after we have all these simulated prices. So we have a future of many different states, many different meteorologies into the future. So think of that 100 forward price sims as really 100 weather sim reps. So 100 different meteorologies into the future. We're going to simulate them. We don't want to use historic record. One, we don't have 100 years worth. And two, it tends to be a little lumpy. So we want to smooth that out. So that's why we're going to use simulated weather. And that, in turn, is going to give us a broad set of conditions that we can then optimize dispatch over. Whether you're dispatched to load or price, these are the conditions that you need to work under. And then we're going to do resource selection. We're going to select what's the optimal resource mix given this set of future outcomes. And finally, summarize the portfolio. What's the least cost, least risk portfolio? Well, in order to do this and build trust in the results, we need to realize the simulations in a way that people can understand that we've achieved meaningful uncertainty. So I just wanted to show you a few simple graphics around some of the core components that are worth keeping your eyes on. So the during delivery spot conditions have weather on the x-axis and load on the y-axis. Are we lining up? Are we capturing load at the high conditions of temperature? And are we consistent with historic? Red is historic, again, blue is simulated, and we're matching up on both extremes. That's good. This is the standard U-shape you'd expect, always centered at around 60 degrees. And heating degree days, cooling degree days are based on 65, but buildings have natural heat effectively from computers and everything else. So 60 seems to be the break point between sloping positive and negative. Have we simulated the weather that's driving this load? And is it consistent with observed values? Can you just show that you're doing that, please? Thank you. Okay. Now that we've simulated weather and we have basic load conditions, how are we doing at the hourly level? Here's August, hours 0 through 23 here on the x-axis, and the y-axis, is load. This is the mean 5th, 95th, again, historic in red and simulated in blue. And what we're seeing here is the expected profile is just as you anticipate, a nice, smooth kind of sine wave for load following the diurnal pattern of the sun. But during extreme temperatures, it's much more peaky, particularly during the hour, I'd say 1600, 1800, than the standard profile. Well, that's something to capture. Well, we're capturing it. The red matches the blue. We're capturing the variability at the 95th percentile very well as a function of weather. This is critical for resource planning and any decision analysis. This is where your risk exposure is during the extreme events. This is where resource adequacy or capacity additions are required, is to meet these conditions. And without simulating weather, you're going to have a harder time, if not impossible time, matching the profiles during extreme events. And then capturing the dynamics as the weather fades into more normal conditions. And then we have maybe a mild spell. Well, is it as flat as the mild spell is? Are we capturing that well? We are. We're nailing the 5th percentile. So this is an important dynamic. Whether we're looking at load or renewables, we want to be able to have the impact of meteorology contemporaneously drive these physical components of weather and generation. And this combines for volumetric uncertainty. Volumetric uncertainty on the load side, volumetric uncertainty on the production side. So planning for tomorrow is inherently much different than it has been in the past because, frankly, this volumetric uncertainty in load, although it's pretty extreme during hot days, it pales in comparison to what we see with the volumetric uncertainty in renewables. And that's something we need to account for. And we need to look at it over a broad set of meteorologies because in planning, we need to look at extremes and plan for those extremes and make sure there's adequate supply for those extreme conditions. One thing we learned in doing Hawaii and 100% renewables is meteorologies do vary a lot. And even with a lot of renewables and, in their case, an extreme amount of batteries that we found economic, you still need some steel in the ground. So planning has changed. Renewables are a component of this. Battery storage may be a component of it. But we need to look at meteorology much more so because the variability in supply is driven by it. This graph in the lower left is months 1 through 12, and load is on the y-axis here on a monthly basis. And we're hitting the monthly average load on the extremes, mean 5th, 95th, just fine too. Another good check. What we're trying to do, though, is instill confidence. That's a during delivery condition, so we've already realized weather and spot. Let's back up, and before we hit during delivery, we simulate natural gas prices and power prices. And that's that forecast forward prices I referenced earlier. This is the mean 5th, 95th of the simulated gas prices. That blue line's the mean. By decree in PowerSim and hopefully everywhere else, the simulations equal that input forward price, forecasted price. So you simulate a broad set of conditions. We assure convergence, and we scale so we exactly meet that to the penny. And then there's some spread around that, as you'd expect, as we introduce uncertainty. As we look at each individual time series price path, what we're seeing is variability, prices moving up and down, and there's a dimension of mean reversion. So the blue line here, we have an extreme at almost $6 and it reverts back down to $3. So when there is a war or some episodic event disrupting gas supply, sending prices higher, they tend to be short-lived disequilibrium events, and then we revert back down to quote-unquote normal market conditions. And that's the dynamic we want to mirror and capture because that's how markets behave. We don't have too many potential wars. We just have to mirror what's expected. And that comes largely through the market. They have option quotes for gas. That works well. But we have to capture that price pattern. So just using classical, it's called geometric Brownian motion, that won't work. We need to introduce mean reversion. And that's true for almost all commodities. They have a mean reverting component. So we have our forward prices set into the future for gas and power, and they're correlated with each other, maybe emissions. We can talk about that separately. But usually in planning, we're all looking at CO2 emissions, and that's something that's akin to gas or power. Obviously, CO2 drives electric prices as well. So that's something to be factored in. CO2 emissions, we don't have an implied volatility. We don't have a history usually that's very meaningful. And there's a lot of unknowns. So does anybody know what type of distribution you use if you don't know much, like, or really anything in this case? When you don't know much, you use a triangular distribution because it's real simple. You have a minimum value, a mode, and then a maximum value. You make a triangle. Regulators can understand triangles. They don't understand normal distributions going off to infinity. So triangles work well. They're easy to interpret. And when you know very little, you just, well, we think the mode is here, and let's go down a bit and up a bit. And I've used this in many very contentious resource plans, triangulars for CO2, and that's worked well too. Once we have the prior to delivery conditions, that's the forwards done, and we've done some of the during delivery conditions, we just talked about load. Now we're into other during delivery conditions, and one of the key ones would be price. And this is just a validation. Hey, can you benchmark to the observed prices that we've seen when we have all these fundamental variables of weather and load and renewables? And do you mirror those prices? Do you probabilistically envelope those future states with the mean 5th, 95th for the month of May here and the month of July here, which is a lot more spiky than the month of May? And yeah, we're matching the 5th mean and 95th in the spikiness of the 95th quite well, and the flatness of the month of May at the 5th mean and 95th. That's good. All right, been able to benchmark reasonably well. Let's move forward. How about with solar? Are you capturing and probabilistically enveloping solar production with observed values? Yeah, we're doing that well, and it's driven by weather. Great. So now we're aligning the pieces, and we can. People can see this, gain some transparency into the black box of simulations. This is the validation book. It's critical to creating trust and understanding of what you're doing and removing the black box. You just need to have some insights that are beyond the expected forward curves that we're used to looking at in resource planning and start looking at the dimensions of uncertainty and substantiating meaningful uncertainty. We did this in 2014 for Northwestern Energy in their acquisition of what's called the Hydros. It's all these about 600 megawatts of hydro generation along the Missouri River. And the Hydros was about a $1 billion acquisition. They represent clean energy, Montana energy for the folks in Montana. They're pretty expensive. And the issue was, what's the risk reduction of these assets to the long-term portfolio supply? And is this worthwhile? In order to calculate that well, you need to have uncertainty. When you're looking at renewables or batteries or projects that are more complex, and they do have a non-fossil component, we need to create a level playing field and determine if there's any value associated with some of the risk reduction, or are they inducing value? Too much solar, frankly, might be the opposite. In California, we're seeing this quite a bit. Wind, by having more wind go into a negatively priced market node, probably isn't going to help your customers very much. These are things that you need to keep your eye on and understand in terms of dynamics. And we just want to be able to substantiate that we're aware of them, and we can communicate them well. With respect to Northwestern, our model was reviewed by the Public Service Commission's consultant, Evergreen Economics, who was ostensibly hired to find fault with PowerSim's simulation engine. The conclusion was we set industry best practices, and the asset was acquired, and it's part of the rate base. It was the largest utility acquisition in 2014 at $1 billion. So getting the details right using this construct works very well in communicating complex issues that can make real decisions and have real value for the ratepayers. Solving the capacity expansion plan. This is where we take all these future states that we've simulated. And so we have the weather driving the load, driving market prices, driving your renewable generation, which in turn drives market prices as well. And we combine those physical conditions with the simulated long-term forwards, and we end up with a series of future states. Those future states then enable us to do resource selection. And we're going to do the resource selection process where we minimize the expected net present value of total costs subject to constraints. And typically the constraints are around common planning constraints. Do you have enough supply to meet load? That's reserve margins. Are there energy constraints? You're not becoming a wholesaler, generating far more electricity than you need. Or a retailer, we are inherently very short. Some balance there, so we want to maintain some balance. And then renewable energy constraint, is there an RPS, or is there some other goal that you want to realize? Ancillary service requirements as well. If you're a balancing authority, you need to keep your eye on this. If you're in an ISO, great, we can ignore this quite well. There's a cost, though, for ancillary services in an ISO. We just want to be aware of those costs. That's a function, typically, of load. The idea is to minimize the net present value of total costs. So the net present value is just a summation as we walk into the future, and we're discounting the future costs and expenditures to today's costs. And this way, we can trade off capital investment today for lower costs for tomorrow, which is a good thing and can benefit ratepayers. Invest some capital, keep the future costs lower and more competitive. Well, that's what the purpose of the planning construct is to maintain competitive rates, least costs, rates, least risk perhaps too. So in planning, I think it's important to run a lot of scenarios and get comfortable with specific options. There are constructs where you have to do optimal capacity expansion planning. And this is an area we work working quite a bit. Allison Weiss is here. Raise your hand. She's the developer of, I should say, not only the developer, but the thought leader behind our stochastic optimization process for capacity expansion planning. And I developed an analogy here. And David Millar usurped it. It kind of broke the rhythm, but we'll get to that in a minute. Expansion planning is where you're adding resources to meet load. There's a little excess resources because you need some reserve margin above your load, the red line. I think people are pretty familiar with expansion plans. The idea here, though, is in minimizing the NPV of total costs, we can also look at this. We can include risk constraints and other hosts of constraints, be it RPS constraints. And we want to find the best plan, not over any one given state. That would be like finding, you know, simulation rep, which would be, I guess, the best downhill mountain biker, David Millar. Not sure how that relates to the triathlon analogy. Ryan Hall, he'd be the best runner, or Michael Phelps, the best swimmer. But we don't want the best cyclist, which which usually has my picture up there. Ryan Hall, Michael Phelps. We want the best triathlete, which would be Dave Scott. And Dave Scott would not do well in a marathon against Ryan Hall or a swim race against Phelps. He would beat me in any bike race, I assure you. but he's the best over all three events combined. And nobody can touch him over all three. And that's the purpose of resource planning with uncertainty. If we take a deterministic view, we're just finding that one plan good for that one future state. And what we need is a plan that's the best over all future states. And that's something that we've been able to realize in our expansion planning module. And you can get at this by running a whole bunch of different scenarios, too. It just takes a lot of runtime. So to be more efficient, Allison Weiss has stepped in and created some optimization that enables us to get there much more rapidly. And this is something we used in Hawaii with great success. Their plan was, which we'll talk about in a minute, was rejected by the commission, and Ascend was called in to help out. And we were quite successful in getting the plan passed. So the fundamental changes that David was talking about in energy supply, I think this leads to a different dimension of resource planning that we've than what we've had in the past. And this is something we need to keep our eyes on, is how are these fundamental changes impacting the decisions we make today for tomorrow? If we're dealing with structural change and we're in declining costs, particularly batteries, renewables as well, how do you make a decision today with respect to the dynamics of tomorrow? And you have an obligation to serve load at least costs. There are investments to be made in order to prepare yourself. Also, we have electric vehicles coming in, which Allison Weiss will be talking about tomorrow as well. It's a complex problem. It's getting multi-sector with the transportation coming into the fold as well. And we need to, in California, you're dealing with this head on, you have to talk about the transportation sector. Some areas it's more appropriate than others. You know, obviously urban areas compared to rural areas. But it's something to be considered. So the fundamental changes are occurring. Renewables are certainly driving more flexible fleets. And this is manifest in the prices that David showed with the price spikes. We only looked at hourly blocks. Actually, before that, we didn't even look at hourly. We used to look at just low duration curves for planning. And we just wanted to make sure we had enough energy at least cost to meet load. Well, now energy's relatively inexpensive. It's almost at the level of the nuclear era boasted in the 70s, too cheap to meter. We're getting there. And what's really critical is to have resources that are highly flexible that can insulate the ratepayer from extreme events where prices are high and adapt to, frankly, garnishing some revenues or insulating the ratepayer from those price spikes. So that means we're down to the 5-minute level now. So we've gone from low duration curves, which is called annual blocks or maybe monthly blocks, to hourly to 5 minutes. And we've done this with many future meteorologies. Thank goodness we have computers. Because when I started this field, my boss was drawing the low duration curves with his French curve ruler. And I had the computer. He was always better with his French curve ruler. But you know, we've come a long way and added a lot of sophistication. And it's only getting more complex. And it's getting more complex in part because the system's getting more, let's say, stochastically driven. There's a larger random component because of weather. And that weather's creating higher volatility. And I'd say also with lower cost of production, higher capital, lower variable costs, lower energy prices. And we might see in some extreme conditions markets where we have solar, wind, and batteries. Can we get a market clearing price that will work? What would that be? And the answer is yes, the markets will work if they're designed well. So flexibility is the binding constraint. That's really true. And I think David's been emphasizing this throughout. And I'm just here to further substantiate that without flexible resources, the ability to shut on and off quickly, there is a risk that you have to be cognizant of. So looking at keeping yourself insulated, and can I supply my own load at least cost, independent of the market interactions. Although be it a traditional approach, it's not recognizing perhaps some of the opportunities to interact with the market in the newer dynamics. And one of the things with renewable integration is the expansion of the EIM, for example, because of the inherent variability in high renewable states, there is some dimension of pooling. We've pooled and integrated as much as possible, frankly, and have market interactions at a computer-driven rate to deal with the variability of renewables. As we increase and increase more renewables, it's going to have to come from the supply side, being more adept at managing the intermittency inherent with renewables. The new dynamics require new thinking and new modeling. It's true. Whenever you see the word structural change and you see that coming and you can statistically substantiate that, and we'll talk a bit more about that tomorrow, new should be in your vocabulary because it's a lot different. And I think the title of the presentation somewhere along in the agenda was, "This is not your boss's resource plan." And the purpose of that is it isn't. It's a lot different because there's so much new. Boss never cared about weather and uncertainty in weather. Never really cared about understanding the variability of weather driving the volumetric uncertainty of supply from renewables versus load and price and how these pieces paired up together. This is not your boss's resource plan. It's far more complex, and the issues involved in order to come up with a plan are more difficult. And some utilities, like Hawaii, have had a hard time. And you need to bring in more advanced models to get there and really create the trust. Speaking of Hawaii, I'll be there in November presenting at some symposium for Hawaii Electric as they continue to evolve their power supply improvement plans. And Hawaii's had a tough time of initial go of the 100% renewables by 2045. In part, it's because of something I call model-limited choice. Their plans were rejected initially because they were working under traditional paradigms where they weren't accounting for these dimensions of uncertainty, and particularly the impact of meteorology on their high renewable fleet. To reach 100% renewables by 2045, that's ambitious. Now, they still are burning fuel. It's just biodiesel. Biodiesel is about 5 times the cost of oil. So not something you want to do very often. They'll do it under very extreme conditions. In 2014, 21% of the energy was from renewables. The rest is imported fossil fuels. The biggest island is Oahu, where Waikiki Beach is, and the naval base, Pearl Harbor. The other islands are about the third size in electric load, Maui and Hawaii. They are all islanded. I should back up. There is the potential to do transmission between Hawaii, the big island, and Oahu. Where's Oahu? But that's Oahu. Oahu. That's Oahu, sorry. That's Maui. So those are the three, Hawaii, Maui, and Oahu. And that's Kauai, which is, no? You would know. Steve Handy knows. I don't know my geography. I just go fly in Oahu every time. Last year was like 5 times. So they are islanded in the true sense of the word. There is the potential for an inter-island cable. The inter-island cable is something that we've looked at. You can do the back of the envelope. You don't need to do advanced modeling to determine it's not going to be economic. And they're going to have each island basically operate on their own, which is too bad because Hawaii has a lot of renewable potential and it's relatively less populated. And Oahu, where all the population lives, there's only so many square miles or feet, in the case of Oahu, that could be designated for solar. You do every rooftop, you do every golf course, you're still short. You do every roadway covered with solar, every parking lot covered with solar, you're still not going to have enough. And then you end up with some offshore wind, but the ocean's pretty deep there, so it's on pontoons. So we came up with a resource plan, and as you can see, it has a mixture of solar here between distributed and utility scale, and onshore wind is very limited in Oahu, and offshore wind. And there's nice balance between solar and wind here. Wind costs quite a bit offshore, but it's a perfect complement to the solar. And so for every megawatt of wind, you need half as much storage as you do for solar. It doesn't take long with a resource of a 20% or so capacity factor, all in a very narrow area with no spatial diversity, really, to be in a condition where you're dumping energy because you have such a concentration of it, you use it too much, or you don't have any. And so wind offshore, although it's more expensive, was a great diversity effect, and we were able to prove that out. So this is the optimal expansion plan. This is that least cost, least risk over a whole bunch of meteorologies. And the plan was built to address some dimensions of variability. I wanted to show you a level of variability here that's pretty traditional. This is an hourly view of dispatch over 3 days. And the black line here is load. Okay, we're going to dispatch the resources to meet load. The yellow is solar. Obviously, we're not dispatching the solar. It's just happening. And that's why we have solar in excess of the peak demand. Hopefully, at some point, we can take this solar and store it. 2025, it's not really economic to store solar from the peak hours of the day and use it in off-peak. Solar has a lot of cost-effective, batteries can be very cost-effective, but not for one cycle a day. That's going to take a lot of time to reduce the cost down to that level. But what we see is the sun comes up, solar kicks up, meets load, and that's great. And then when the sun sets, the thermal generation comes on. Their fleet is almost all oil, gas, steam. This ramp, which you know, kind of like the duck ramp, is not conducive to oil gas steam. You need to keep those oil gas steam units simmering during the day effectively to come on and meet that ramp. In order to go 100% renewable in Hawaii, they have to effectively scrap their entire fleet of thermal generation, that's oil gas steam, which is like 80% of their fleet, and build a new fleet almost of the exact same capacity, because there are conditions where you're going to need some very extreme meteorologies where the batteries can't charge, and there is enough wind, and you have no choice but to run your thermal. Even at 100% renewable with 7,000 megawatts of hours of storage, you still need to run thermal. And we can go into more details on this, but it's important to know that 100% renewable is very challenging, and it's challenging because of the meteorology. There are just extreme conditions you need to account for. And then the second reason it's challenging is the variability induced by meteorology. So flexibility becomes at a premium. It did not go over well that in order to go to 100% renewable, we have to add a lot of new thermal generation. I thought we were getting rid of the thermal generation. Why are we investing more dollars in thermal than we ever anticipated in order to go to 100% renewable? We got it through. But that was something that, and if you speak to any operator there, they were convinced that there was this issue of variability, and they needed flexibility, and they're in the control room, and they just don't have it. So we really championed their cause by getting the modeling to understand the system flexibility. And that's something I want to go over now, is flexibility requirements. So we have a piece of software called PowerFlex. PowerFlex has been used throughout the country now on determining the amount of regulation and Inc., not a 15-minute ramp up, required to maintain the system at 60 hertz. So 60 hertz is kind of the ballast point. You want to be there. A little bit low, not good. You need to crank up generation. A little high, you need to ink down. That's called DEC. So you want to keep things at 60 hertz. And what we have here is Hawaii in 2020. And what we're looking at is the blue line is their load, minutely. The red line is the hourly integrated net load. So that's the blue line minus the yellow from solar and the green from the wind. The minutely load is the light blue line. Now, you can see the light blue and the red are obviously tracking each other. The red is just the hourly moving average. But what you see is sawtooths in their net load in the red line. Well, the system has to meet these sawtooths multiple cycles a day. So we've gone from four changes in gradient, kind of a nice sine wave here of load, to, well, a sawtooth pattern with nine changes in gradient, nine changes in slope. And this is a lot different system in red than meeting the system in blue. Your thermal fleet needs to be a lot different to meet red compared to dark blue. And that was the point. Batteries have a role here in Hawaii. Why? Because we have a lot of dump energy here in excessive load. That's, and then you add in the little bit of green here for wind, and it's even more so. So they can help with smoothing out the sawtooths. Batteries, they can also help with regulation. So batteries are very cost effective, and Allison will talk about this tomorrow, in high cycles conditions. In other words, moving them up and down multiple times a day, at least a dozen times a day. They're not economic for on-peak to off-peak. The approach in California, four-hour energy storage, it's an interesting idea. The motivation came from using traditional models and the duck curve. But the issue isn't around meeting a four-hour ramp with a battery. The issue is around meeting the sawtooth patterns that you have because of renewables. And that's something that batteries are very cost-effective at. They're even more cost-effective at regulation, which is cycling almost minutely, a high cycle. You might have 12 cycles an hour with regulation, up-down. So much higher frequency. Very cost-effective there today as a whole, and we'll talk tomorrow about why that's the case. Pretty cost-effective in getting there, certainly for Hawaii, at removing the sawtooths. Mid-20s, this is very cost-effective to remove the sawtooths. Right now, it's still only regulation. Regulation requirements in 2020, the base is 220 megawatts. The ramp for 1 hour is 600 megawatts during the day. The ramp during the night is half that, 221, and the regulation is 18. It's all driven by sun. Hawaii is looking at 1 hour because they're islanded. If this was in the mainland here, this would be, instead of 1 hour, it would be 15 minutes. And their threshold around regulation is higher than it is on the mainland, too, because there's no interconnection capabilities. Let's go ahead and add 400 megawatts of solar. Regulation went up from 220 to 336, so 136 megawatts increase in regulation. Ramp went up to 812 megawatts, which is 153 megawatt increase in 1 hour ramp. Nighttime, there's no change, as you'd expect. Sun doesn't shine during the night. Same pattern, same day I picked out. So now we know our amount of regulation in ramp, or ink, as we call it here, for adding 400 megawatts of solar. Well, let's do the same thing, but add 400 megawatts of wind. Also, we're dumping about 1,500 megawatt hours more of energy by adding 400 megawatt hours of solar. If we add 400 megawatts of wind, we end up with creating 450 megawatt hours more dump energy. That's a lot less, right? That's 1,000 megawatt hours, two-thirds less. Even better than that, 70% less. Regulation, it only increased by 5 megawatts from that 336 base. That's great. Nighttime regulation, it did go up a bit, 46 megawatts versus zero. But overall, that's much better than what we had with an increase of 116 megawatts in regulation and a ramp of 153. So the ramp is only up 30 megawatts. This is the portfolio effects I was talking about of wind combined with the solar on the system. It's a nice complement. It works well. We're seeing this work well, not just on an energy complement side, but on an ancillary service complement side and system stability side. These are things to look at and understand. It's why we need to get more involved in modeling with meteorology as a key driver. It wasn't a key driver if this is your system load that you're trying to meet. You don't have to worry about weather that much. There's some variability, some extreme conditions, but nothing that's out of bounds compared to this net load. Different paradigm. And you need to understand and have the flexible requirements as key drivers of decision analysis for tomorrow, because these flexible requirements are the new resources you need to bring on. And you need to evaluate the effects of flexibility on the economic merits of different resource options. And that's why we need to get down to 5-minute level prices and even minutely level dispatch. Good thing we have computers operating in a distributed framework, otherwise we'd be waiting a long time. Switching off of Hawaii to someplace where you do have spatial diversity, I wanted to kind of follow this theme of adding different resources and complements. And spatial diversity is something that's asked a lot of us to look at. And this is an example for Northwestern Energy, part of their filings. And this is adding from 1 to 7 wind sites. And the amount of capacity needed for flexibility, or ink, declines as we add more and more sites. After we hit the 6, so we're at 260 megawatts of ink for one wind farm of the same capacity. And this is total capacity is 700 megawatts. And as we add two resources, two sites, same capacity, we end up with 200 megawatts. And add the third, it's just 180 megawatts. And we go down to the 6th, and we're at about 125 megawatts, and the 7th is still 125. So it's a declining marginal benefits around spatial diversity. And then once you hit the 6th, you're done. There's no more spatial benefits to be added. So that's interesting. Same thing with solar. We see almost the same pattern. It depends, though. Solar is much is a little different because the clouds move from west to east, and you tend to align solar facilities, at least in California, north to south. There's not typically as much benefit spatial diversity for solar as there is for wind. But something to keep in mind. And these are the kind of new planning questions that are emerging. We weren't concerned with spatial diversity effects 10 years ago. Not your boss's resource plan. That's changing. Go ahead, Phil.
That was 700 megawatts spread over X number of sites, or that was 700 megawatts per site?
700 megawatts, and then in this case we divided by two, okay. Two different sites and three different sites. We try to find, space them at least 50 miles apart. So they weren't in the same wind regime. But they're still in the state, in this case the state of Montana. I think it's back to you for changing planning paradigms.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yes.
How did their rate forecast turn out, relative to historical, with basically a whole new fleet of resources?
Their historic rates are very high. So they're saving on fuel costs, and the expectation is that there won't be a net increase in rates because they're saving on fuel costs with all the solar and wind they're building. It is a big push to get the new thermal fleet in. That's already underway, though. Built 50 megawatts of, Phil just left, 50 megawatts of Wärtsilä engines on Pearl Harbor, but it's basically controlled by Hawaii Electric. So that's underway. And they need to address their inflexible thermal fleets before they can almost do anything and add batteries for regulation immediately, and they're doing both those things. So those are two big outcomes they're acting on immediately. In terms of building solar highways, they're not doing that yet. But it's something down the road. Offshore wind is obviously something further down the road, too. But they're aggressively adding solar. There's no question about it. And other renewables and outside of Oahu. There they have geothermal. Yeah. Okay. Can I send this back to you as a question? Because we were just talking about this yesterday. So I think this is something around, gets back to the reliability issue of DOE, the concept of inertia. It is true that if you have a system that has inertia, it does provide some stability to the grid. It's also equally true that our co-location facility where our computers are at is extremely reliable in maintaining power supply, and we have no inertia. We have battery backup. So do you need inertia with batteries in the system at a reasonable level? You don't. Inertia is completely unnecessary. It's a good byproduct of thermal generation. It's one of those nice externalities, but it's, let's say, superfluous and unnecessary with batteries. So the answer is they'll be fine without any inertia as long as they have a large fleet of batteries. Hawaii's looking at 7,000 megawatt hours of batteries. Their peak load is about 1,200 megawatts. So a typical day, they're having more than double the amount of energy stored that they need in batteries. So it's geared towards extreme conditions, and even that isn't enough to cover the 40 rainy days in a row in February. Or January, February, that would end up with the batteries completely drained during some intervals, and there just isn't enough wind to run the islands, at least economically. So you turn on your biodiesel. But even in 2045, they'll be running biodiesel. There's no way around it. And we've also seen, the hurricanes come through, Puerto Rico most recently. Those exposed systems of renewables, frankly, don't fare that well under hurricane winds. And having the thermal fleet will be necessary in an island to, as we've just seen, to maintain power supply.
I also add that, modern inverters connected to wind plants can actually provide synthetic inertia as well. So I think, like Gary said, with modern technology and batteries and inverters, you can run a system without anything spinning.
All right.
All right, so this is the end of this section. And so we talked about the linkage between weather, renewable generation, and market prices. We talked about planning for integration. How do we think about the capacity value of renewables and diversity? And then also we talked about how do we understand and quantify the value of flexible resources for integration? And last but not least, we also talked about how do we plan for all future states, not just the baseline and a few scenarios your management team picked, which is reminiscent of how I've seen things done in a previous employer, but rather how do you look at all future states. And we can do that with computers and do that in a smart way. So we have probably about 30 minutes left and just to talk a bit about distributed energy resources. And this is becoming more and more of a concern, both challenges and opportunities for utilities. Distributed energy resources, or just DERs, it's something that is a way for the utility to engage with their customers. This is something that customers want. They want the solar panel. They want that their Tesla or Chevy Volt in their garage. They may want, especially after hurricanes and fires, they may want a battery pack in the garage to keep their fridge going and their house going for those few hours that they're probably going to be out. So, as planners, we need to really understand and plan for how this is going to affect the system, how this affects everything across the chain, from generation through transmission and distribution. So let's talk a bit about the future of the grid, and we'll have a little exercise to get people out of their chairs. But first, let's talk about what are DERs? What do people? Let's get some ideas. What are DERs in your service where you are, and maybe give an example of how those are affecting you or coming in.
We have PV generation.
Rooftop behind the meter. Community solar, okay. What does that mean for you, community solar?
So for us, it's an actual utility-owned resource that's essentially leased by the member.
Mm-hmm.
But it's distributed throughout our distribution.
Mm-hmm. So okay, and is this sited behind the bus bar on the distribution side, or is it?
Mm-hmm.
Got it. All right. So solar interconnected can be either on the transmission side, the bulk power system side of the bus bar, or it can be at utilities distribution system. Any other DERs folks are seeing in their service territories? Micro hydro.
On the member side of the meter, and then we have less than 10 megawatt generation.
Huh. That's interesting. I haven't heard of small hydro as a DER, but yeah, that makes sense. We have anyone getting electric vehicles interconnected? Yeah.
No, but nobody's interconnected.
No. Okay.
They're not using
the okay. So they're not. Right, they're just like plugging in their home, but we're not doing bulk energy services yet. So we have smart thermostats. Anybody have any smart thermostat programs? Yep. Flexible.
We have a pilot right now with a couple hundred Nest and Honeywell Lyric.
Mm-hmm.
And we use it for like ACL.
Mm-hmm. Use it for demand response. Okay. Yeah. Batteries, obviously, both sort of larger batteries that might be in the transmission or distribution system, behind the meter. Energy efficiency, do people think of that as distributed? Yeah. I see Jane's nodding her head. You'll be talking about that tomorrow, right? Yep. All right. So there's a whole galaxy of different things that are emerging. And so each one has their own unique attributes and possibilities. Let's try this little exercise. Everybody, please stand up. This is a get out of your seats exercise. Okay. So this is a sociogram. A sociogram means you're going to move with your feet to one side of the room or the other, depending on where you think, where you stand on this question. And the question is, what do you think the grid will look like in 2030? So on one side, the very far side, it's just the old one-way flow generation to customer. On the other side, that side, it's going to be totally distributed. So we're talking, you know, we're doing efficiency, lots of demand response. We're using blockchain and transactive energy to do behind the meter and other types of transactions of energy. We have autonomous electric transportation, doing grid services, doing autonomous driverless cars, supply sides, just renewable storage, maybe bigger markets, and then integration. So sort yourselves to where. So if you think it's going to be 50-50, stand in the middle. I know we're kind of like, got yeah. Do the best you can in staggered maybe. If you think it, you know. So go put yourself where you think it's going to be.
Yeah.
I think, well, let's do where you come from. Let's do where you come from. So that's old school. This is DRs. 2030. Yeah. All right, now go ahead and talk to your neighbors for like a few minutes of why you decided that where you stand. Yeah.
Seems to be in that trajectory, but all the regulatory and everything, it's not clear how they're going to.
Well, they want, from a regulatory perspective, they want to do it. They're going to win, right? There they go.
In California, they will.
In California, yeah. But 2030, I don't know if that's
that's
soon enough
weird,
to get them all there, all the time.
No, it may not be all there, but
yeah.
It's headed in.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They have it right.
Yeah. So we're already planning for that. I mean, 2030 is one of our targets. So in Missouri's kind of ass backwards from a regulatory standpoint. They're real regressive. Illinois, however, is real progressive. And so they're looking at a lot of things. And so there's a whole big effort, I think it's called Next Grid. So they're looking at a lot of this stuff, and they're already looking at how to integrate this, smart inverters, all this DER, energy efficiency, demand response. And while it takes a little bit longer in Missouri, they're still having that conversation. I would say it's a conversation that Illinois had 10 years ago, but 2030 is our target, and we're already trying to figure out what that looks like. We released an IRP a couple of weeks ago, and it had an extra 400 megawatts of wind. So we had 300 megawatts, now we have 700. And we're going to retire two more of our coal facilities, or four more units, in the 30s. But before, we were just going to retire two units instead of. So now we're retiring
four.
So
it's accelerating.
Yeah. I mean, and this has happened within, that I've seen in the past year, in the culture at Amber.
What's your target for 2030?
Well, our target is that bottom.
Got it.
Missouri also doesn't like to be told what to do and be compared to another state, so it's coming. It's slow, but we're working. I mean, we're working with those guys every day, every year. We try and push some legislation through. Modernize the grid in Missouri like we did in Illinois. And I think that goes down.
So if we can take our
service area and create a microgrid.
Sorry, I left my parking. It's about to expire.
Oh, no, it's okay. We're talking about, you know, where we think, oops, where we think we're going to be between distributed grid or the old school grid, just kind of physically. All right, let's wrap up conversations. Okay, before you move, so let's hear from some folks why they chose where they are. So maybe someone on the, let's start with the more traditional side. Why did you choose to stand over there?
I'm a lot more from the Midwest.
That's interesting. We got some Midwest people over here too, so that'll be it'll be interesting to see here the differences there. So, okay, you're in the Midwest, and why is that more traditional? More is just more like utility scale, bigger. Renewables push. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
We're still a vertically integrated utility, which is somewhat unusual for California.
Yeah, please, sorry, pass the mics.
Yes, we're still a vertically integrated utility, which is somewhat unusual for a utility in California. We also don't have the demographics that would support the rates that would be required to move to a distributed grid. And sure, we're going to be moving that way, but we're not going to be leading the pack. We might be able to dabble a little bit in transportation because it makes economic sense, but it's not going to be widely adopted like in areas like San Jose or the Bay Area or Southern California, LA area. Those kinds of things would be in the distributed grid, mm-hmm. would be very popular, but it's just not popular with our ratepayers.
Yeah.
And we are municipal, and so we very much are interested in what our ratepayers want, and we kind of go, in some sense, kicking and screaming with the policies that are coming out of Sacramento.
Mm-hmm.
We're just one of those that are pushing back, and we're not pushing back because we're an obstinate utility. We're a very small municipal. We just are looking after our ratepayers' interests.
Yep. Yeah, yeah. I mean, economic issues. I mean, as planners, maybe another thing that's emerging that isn't traditional is that you need to be considering of these economic issues in terms of your customers. I mean, I guess it's always been about keeping rates low, but. Yeah, as we try and balance multiple objectives, environmental, technology, and ratepayers, this is a big concern. I mean, this is the end of the day, this is the job.
You know, and having said what I've just said, I also see the need for our utility to have a green tariff,
mm-hmm.
because a green tariff would be an invitation for bigger businesses and things to come to our area. So we're not completely unaware of the world around us. And if we had a green tariff, and that's something that I am going to, I guess, push for in the coming
mm-hmm.
years and months and as we go through the IRP, we want to be open to the opportunities that would bring to improve the situation where maybe we get more into the distributed grid area faster because of growth. We're just not seeing the growth in our area to also make change. And most changes in the past have all come because of the increasing load. You're able to solve a lot of problems with your increasing load, and you bring on new units, you retire old units, and with the declining loads, we're seeing that especially in California, we're over capacity.
Yep.
And with that, there's less opportunity to make changes, and or if you do make changes, they are stranded assets. So it's very costly to do the ideal distributed grid.
Do people associate this with higher costs, or do you think there's opportunities here to save money for the ratepayers in the distributed, going more distributed? Just put it out there. Just think about our assumptions. Maybe there are opportunities and there are more expensive things.
Well, in Hawaii, as Gary just said, it's not, well, the rates are not going up.
Yeah.
Even though some parts of it are way more expensive. So.
Yeah. Let's hear from someone on this side of the room who said, we're going totally distributed. Going to be like the eBay of energy. Out there.
I'm from Amber, Missouri. So in Missouri, we're vertically integrated, but in Illinois, we're just a pipes and wires company. So that 2030, that bottom half of that slide is our target, is what we see happening at that time. So, you know, the effort is right now not to make that happen in 2017 or before 2030, but that's what we see happening. And so really it's a big effort, and I've been drinking the Kool-Aid for about 2 years now, so I'm all in on that one. But it's an effort to try and understand how do we do that, and how do we keep the rates low, because what we're seeing right now is some of that stuff's at grid parity, and by 2030 nearly all of it will be at grid parity. So it's really an effort to maximize the value for Ameren while keeping the value for our customers that have some of the lowest rates in the country.
Yeah. Anyone in the middle? Yeah, you want to read over here? Puget Sound? Yeah.
Thank you. I just wanted to add about the green tariff and about keeping rates low, that, and Dave, you spoke to this earlier, that we have tariff programs that allow customers to choose to pay higher rates commensurate with their worldviews and their desires for carbon reduction. And I believe that we have close to 90,000 residential customers that are in the Green Power Program, which is paying higher rates, going into a trust fund for build outs for future renewables, and then also the Green Direct Program, where Starbucks, REI, Trader Joe's, different staple companies in the area are choosing to pay higher rates and getting changing the grid in that way. And that's why I'm standing right here in the middle, because it's customer focused, but goes into the supply side. Ultimately, we would be the ones building out to meet the needs of our customers and their desires.
Anybody else want to weigh in on DERs? And
you know, I don't mind to, I don't mean to
yeah, please come on up.
But the Hawaii rates were brought up, and yeah. Having lived in Hawaii, I know something a little bit about the rates. Now, I lived on Kauai, which is a cooperative. It's a different utility than the Hawaii, the other six islands. My experience on Kauai was their rates were in the range of 35 to 48 cents a kilowatt hour. You can do a lot with those rates.
Mm-hmm.
You start moving the costs from variable fuel costs to capital and capital investments, and you can do a lot of that. And I will have to say, in our case in Redding now, we have some of the lowest rates in the state. And we can't do a lot right now with those rates. And our customers, our ratepayers, are very sensitive to our rates. So we don't have the elasticity is
right.
Very real there. I mean, you raise rates and energy drops, except for the summer months where everyone's got to have their air conditioning on and ready.
Yeah, right. Well, can I offer that that's a really good opportunity as electric vehicle prices come down, that customers can really take advantage of those low rates and do their transportation.
And as soon as the trucks come with electric trucks, I think we might have something there.
Yeah.
And something you can put big tires on, we might have something there.
Yeah, electric tractors and, well, I mean, and electric drives have, amazing torque, right? And if you're not going long ranges, it's actually a really good application. Okay, well, let's go ahead and sit down and continue the DER talk at lunch. We're getting close. I know I'm between, people are probably getting hungry, so let's bring it in here for a landing. So I'm just going to propose this as a framework for incorporating distributed energy resources in your resources plans, is that we really need to understand the characteristics and the value propositions for each technology. And it's the value proposition to the customer, it's the value proposition to the utility, it's the value proposition to the grid. Because these DERs, they have different values for different different parts of the energy system. And we need to really understand that, so we need to do the studies. If you were looking at your own service territory, you want to forecast adoption. Look at historic data. And we're going to do some forecasting, so we need to know how much should we expect behind the meter solar to come into our service territory. And in PG&E, where the rates are high and you have increasing block tiers, obviously there's a huge incentive to go rooftop solar. But if you go pop over into Reading, it's going to be much different, very almost no incentive. It doesn't make sense economically. So your rate, your system, your rate structure, your cost structure, this is all important. And obviously, this is going to have, especially skipping ahead, but this is going to have big implications for your business model. And you need to sort of understand that. So we'll talk a little bit about forecasting. A lot of these DERs are basically load modifiers. So this is something that is going to reduce your energy sales. When you look at efficiency, what should we expect in terms of how does energy efficiency programs reduce load? And also, increasingly more important, when does energy efficiency reduce load? If energy efficiency is just savings at any time of day, it really loses value. Because, again, we saw earlier, renewables are driving down the prices of energy. So if you're evaluating your efficiency program based on what it's replacing, what it's displacing, if it's displacing practically zero cost, middle of the day energy, it's not worth anything. So efficiency has to be targeted in the future. If you could do it on the peak, those lighting programs, or time of use rates. I just voluntarily signed up for Xcel's time of use rate because I'm obviously kind of a crazy energy nerd. But their rates are their peak period is 2 to 6. I think PG&E's is 4 to 9. Because that's actually more aligned with the peak value in a solar state. So you need to modify your load forecast, and you understand how that's going to affect that, and then the supply side will adjust accordingly. We also want to consider analyzing DERs as a resource, right? Demand side, supply side, in the end it doesn't really matter, these are all resources. So we need to say, maybe we have an expected natural growth of efficiency behind the meter. Maybe it's cost effective, and maybe there's other reasons why we would want to support more deployment of distributed energy resources with our customers. And so we can actually specify what those sort of the costs and benefits of those resources as part of an expansion planning exercise. So we in PowerSim, we just basically characterize DERs as a supply resource, and the model can pick when it's cost effective. We also want to study the implications of deployment on the business model and the grid system. So, for example, and if with DERs, you have to understand what is the, not only just the generalized value, but what is the specific locational value? So does it make sense to put a battery on this congested circuit, or does it, you know, or should we add solar here with smart inverters? So this is a very complicated, difficult process to really understand the grid needs at a micro scale. So that is sort of the next generation of looking at DERs and its real true value. So we're going to want to study that. We're going to want to study the effect on the business model. So is rooftop solar enough of a threat to really put the business model at risk? Do we have a utility death spiral issue? Some places, you know, those places with higher rates, it's a real issue because it's basically the customer exiting the system with something that's cheaper to them. And that tends to socialize the costs, especially with net metering, onto the other rate payers. Their prices go up. Sorry. And that, again, that's the death spiral. That's pushing the death spiral. So is this an issue? Do we need to understand the hosting capacity? And then, you know, again, it's a continuing cycle. We're going to want to keep, as technology is changing so quickly, and things are evolving so quickly, we need to be revisiting this sort of constantly. Just a few models for thinking about how to look at innovations. So this is a common and simplified but effective way to think about the diffusion of innovations. And this model is used for all sorts of new technologies. But basically, the idea is you categorize customers, people, into innovators, early adopters, early majority, late majority, or laggards. And this is, as you see, basically, market share goes up to 100. It's a bell curve. But this is basically a way, and you can specify models econometrically. You can use historic data. You can use similar technologies. For example, you could use like plug-in Priuses or hybrids as a proxy for electric vehicles. You could study that. But basically, you can use a Bass diffusion model to try and figure out what should we expect for adoption based on similar conditions. Obviously, in California, you kind of see the same rapid growth of behind-the-meter solar. You can see where it is. Obviously, it's more concentrated in wealthier areas, and it's more concentrated in places where it's hot and you use a lot of electricity, Central Valley in particular. So, why? Well, we have full retail rate compensation, typically net metering, and this is has a subsidy effect because basically you're avoiding the transmission and distribution costs you're normally paying. Because you're getting full retail compensation for just the energy. Energy, which is actually doesn't really have a lot of value. You could just go on the market and buy it much more cheaply. So these costs are typically socialized. So this is why kind of seeing a lot of utilities nationwide pushing back on net metering, doing much more sophisticated net metering 2.0, 3.0 types of tariffs that are going to fix some of these distorted price signals. Also, they tend to incentivize just gross amount of power, so they maximize for energy, when really what we want to do is maximize for peak. So we want to actually orient them more to the west in order to capture the best value, not maximize for energy. So with behind-the-meter forecasting, I'm just drawing on experience from PG&E. Suni can also weigh in on this. She worked with me on this. But we need to look at what technical potential, so look at things like rooftop space, southern exposure, tree cover, places with a lot of trees, not as much technical potential, but also looking at economics, rate structure, rate level. Declining cost curves, obviously this is going to become more cost competitive, but then again, you also have declining incentives like the ATC, taking all those things into account. But also understand that there are solar leasing models that have just a bill savings calculation that's that's not the typical sort of capital expenditure calculation. So this is why, this is part of the reason why California has really exploded, is this sort of business model innovation in terms of adding solar through leasing. You can do this on Google right now. I just typed in my address, so now you know my address, but you know, and solar, and then you get, it tells you whether it makes sense for you to do a 20-year solar lease. For me, it doesn't make, it would be net negative $3,000, so it doesn't make any sense for me. Excel rates are just too cheap. And but I do think, you know, when eventually we need to replace the roof, then the Tesla solar roof would be the way to go. That's my plan. you know, batteries, you know, again, I think the same cost decline trajectory or even more aggressive than solar. You know, electric vehicle battery costs have dropped 80% in 6 years. Now it says 227 per kilowatt hour. This, according to the McKinsey study, it's going to be, you know, down to 150-ish in 2020 and below 100 in 2030. I mean, this is structural change. This can mean, you know, the complete transition to electric vehicles, and which is, you know, should be great. The utility, frankly, needs this. I mean, this is critical for the model. And you know, we've heard about the Gigafactory in Nevada. You know, China's actually, I've heard so many numbers about gigafactories in China, anywhere from 10 to 20, but I just put many. but we're really driving down the cost here. So, you know, maybe I've drank the Kool-Aid too, but I think we will be seeing autonomous, shared, connected, and electrified transportation within a short time, within our lifetimes, certainly. I'll just kind of let you guys read this when you download the presentation, but this is Bloomberg New Energy Finance thinks EVs are 54% new car sales by 2040. Second half of the 2020s, plunging lithium-ion battery prices will be the real inflection point. It displaces 8 million barrels of transportation fuel per day, adds 5% to global electricity consumption. So if you just some base, you know, quick back of the envelope calculations, 5 million vehicles in the service territory, 50% of those are electric, it's 2.5 million vehicles, it's about 10 kilowatt hours per day, 25,000 megawatt hours per day, it's about a gigawatt base load plant to cover that. So that'd be a nice capital investment. And, you know, contrary to, I think, to some conventional wisdom, it actually is pretty much always better from a greenhouse gas perspective to drive an electric vehicle, even if you're in the Midwest where there's a lot of coal. This is just from, you know, a study that Union Concerned Scientists, so, I mean, take it what you will, but that you have, basically, this is the equivalent, if you're in California, it's the equivalent of 87 miles per gallon vehicle. If you're in the Northwest, 94 miles per gallon. If you're in the Midwest, it's you know, 35, but it's still better than most cars. And Allison will, you know, get into this in much more detail tomorrow, but, you know, there are options in terms of providing grid services with smart charging. So we can figure out, yeah, we're going to add these EVs, but now we want to figure out, okay, how do we optimally control the EVs? And EVs may not, you know, may not be going up and down to do a sort of regulation, but you can certainly sort of stop charging or charge when you need. We're trying to get people to charge in the middle of the day when the solar is peaking, for example, give them really good rates. Finally, just some thoughts on energy efficiency. Energy efficiency programs have been going on for a long time. They've been doing evaluation studies for a long time. They're still really hard to get right. we need to figure out you know, with load forecasting, you know, basically there's three approaches. One is doing econometric modeling, and then we need to try and figure out, well, how much energy efficiency is embedded in the historic data set, try and parse that out so we know what's additional, what's not. End-use models is, you know, basically a bottoms-up accounting of end-use saturations, efficiencies, and run hours, and this is sort of the count the light bulbs approach that I call it. Just very data-intensive, very model-intensive. Most individual utilities aren't doing this, but. And then there's some hybrid models that incorporate elements of both. But the bottom line is that it is hard to do well, and you know, the sort of EE savings, ex post MEV savings are sort of, notoriously unreliable, and they just, you know, they'll fight over these methodological and data issues for years trying to figure out what the energy efficiency savings actually was. And it's sort of, I think it's hard to parse out what's sort of naturally occurring energy efficiency versus what's additional, right? What's actually the effect of the utility program. So what do we do? Well, you know, we want to look at ways to incorporate uncertainty. And we can do that. We can do Monte Carlo simulations. It's a longer topic. We can go into another time. So I just want to wrap up. I think it's just about out of time. Yep, perfect. So, you know, last but not least, you know, in this new planning paradigm, we're doing all these things we've looked at before. We also need to understand and plan for distributed energy resources, figure out, you know, how are these tools, how are these going to be good ways to engage with their customers, and how are we going to, you know, help support them in achieving what they want as part of their energy mix. And just leave on a quote. Norman Foster is a British architect, built the sort of tubular or rocket ship building in London. You may have seen. It looks like kind of a big fat cigar. Anyways, he says, as an architect, you design for the present with an awareness of the past for a future which is essentially unknown. And I think that's really what our jobs are, is we're planning for a future that's essentially unknown. We know about the past, but we're not wedded to the past. We're fully embracing the fact that, you know, the future, times change, we need to embrace that, and we need to plan for the future. And we need to keep in mind that, you know, in the present, we have obligations to our ratepayers, shareholders, that we need to be mindful for. So we're walking a tightrope, but it's an exciting time and very interesting and lots to discuss. So thank you.